Thank you for making the trip to be here this morning. We truly appreciate your attendance here, your support, your prayers. Is very humbling, and we are honored to be here today, and I truly mean that. If you would, as a courtesy, before we begin, to the speakers today and to those sitting around you, if you would, take your cell phone and either turn the ringer to off. If you don't know how to do that, if you would, just turn it off. You see what a geek I am. I can't even get my own. No, there we go. That's greatly appreciated. We'll have opportunities to switch them back on if need to check in and get messages and so forth. Oh, and also as a courtesy to others who might be not able to attend this morning but very interested in the topics of discussion, if you would just with me take your phone, even if you shut it off, and just say with me, "Hello, FBI." Hello, FBI. Okay, now the reason I did that will become apparent over the course of the next hour. Because you see, we here in the United States and probably most of the technologically advanced, they cannot hear. Let me use the wireless microphone this way. Okay. I'll begin again. We here in the West, the technologically advanced nations of the US, UK, Canada, etc., we live in a state of constant surveillance. Closed circuit TV cameras follow our every moves. Drive through a red light, use an ATM, park in a downtown parking garage, even go to the Quickie Mart, buy a slushie, smile, you're on camera. We accept it as normal that our movements can be tracked through the use of our electronic devices, our cell phones, credit card purchases. In fact, isn't anyone who uses cash anymore just a little bit suspicious? You see, we are willing inmates. We are making ourselves inmates of a virtual panopticon. And I'll define that term in more depth later on. Through the technology that we take for granted, we are happily trading information and our privacy for convenience, entertainment, and security, or the illusion thereof. You see, we are weaving the ropes that the global elites want to use to hang us. So let's look at some of the strands of this rope. The United States has essentially become spies are us. The Washington Post recently conducted a two-year investigation, published the results in July of this year. Their conclusions that the top secret world that the United States government has created in response to 9/11 is so large, so vast, and so secret that nobody truly knows how much money we're spending on it, how many people it employs, how many programs exist, and how many agencies are duplicating the work of others. The investigation's other findings include that some 1,271 government organizations, 1,931 private contractors are working on programs related to counterterrorism, homeland security, and intelligence gathering in about 10,000 locations scattered across the United States. An estimated 854,000 people, about 1.5 times the population of Washington, D.C., now hold top secret security clearance. And in Washington and the surrounding areas, and you'll appreciate this if you enjoy occult numerology, since 9/11, some 33 buildings for top secret intelligence have been built or are in the process of being built. Together, they occupy the equivalent of about 3 pentagons, 22 U.S. Capitol buildings, about 17 million square feet of space altogether. One of the elements of this national security state is, of course, the National Security Agency. This is the largest collection of geeks in the Western world. There's a joke at Fort Meade, which is the headquarters of the NSA, that you can always spot the extrovert. He's the guy looking at other people's shoes. But it's not a joke. This collection of hackers and mathematicians runs the largest data collection and analysis operation in the world. For example, the Information Awareness Office. And how's that for a logo? Yeah, conspiracy theorist's worst nightmare. The Information Awareness Office was created in 1992 by DARPA, which is the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. The intent was to use surveillance and information technology to monitor terrorists and other threats to national security by collecting, well, by achieving total information awareness. The idea was to use a mosaic approach to intelligence. Gather everything, and I mean everything, emails, phone calls, medical records, biometric data, facial recognition software, DNA, your fingerprints, collect it all, and then try to form a picture. Now, this is so over the top that this almost had to be a stalking horse. I mean, look at that. This is almost like a thumb in the eye of conspiracy theorists. I'm convinced that the very idea of the total information awareness concept was intended to draw out conspiracy theorists and then defund it, which Congress did in 2003. I mean, even the acronym IAO is the name of the supreme deity in the Gnostic Mass of Aleister Crowley. I mean, come on. Well, it was defunded in 2003, but never fear, we're still safe. Other projects run by NSA that do exactly the same thing are still in operation. For example, novel intelligence from massive data. There's a little chart there showing the flow of information. Not only does this have the capability to take in all of that data that the Total Information Awareness Program was intended to collect, it finds hidden relationships between these data points and even critiques the thinking and comes up with alternate hypotheses from the human analysts working for the NSA. Anyone here see the movie Eagle Eye?
Yeah.
Billy Bob Thornton, Shia LaBeouf, or however you pronounce that kid's name? There was a Shia LaBeouf? Thank you. There was a computer program at the heart of the national security apparatus in that film called ARIA, Autonomous Reconnaissance Intelligence Integration Analyst. And its purpose was to take all this data, analyze, and neutralize threats to national security. NIMD comes across like the precursor to ARIA. Of course, the downside in the film was that ARIA determined that the president was a threat to national security and had to be taken out, so there you go. Another program the NSA has been running since 1971, Echelon. This is a joint operation of the US, UK, Australia, and New Zealand. The United States does not officially recognize that this program exists. But the Aussies and the Kiwis have kind of spilled the beans. We're doing that. This is a picture of one of the intelligence gathering sites, which is estimated to intercept up to 90% of all internet traffic. It may intercept up to 3 billion communications a day, phone calls, emails, satellite transmissions, internet downloads, all looking for patterns and keywords that might indicate a threat to national security. Now, interestingly, this site, just an observation here, bears a striking resemblance to a rather iconic image from a classic television program that also illustrated very well the concept of the panopticon. Anyone recognize that? That's Rover from the classic television program, The Prisoner, Patrick McGoohan. He saw this coming in the 1960s. If you've never seen The Prisoner, find the DVDs at Netflix or wherever. Watch it. The more I learned about the panopticon, the more The Prisoner makes sense. Patrick McGoohan saw it coming in the mid-60s and illustrated it beautifully. More recent piece of this crypto puzzle that the NSA is trying to put together is called Perfect Citizen. This was just announced in July. Perfect Citizen is intended to monitor and protect older computer networks, networks developed before the threat of cyber hacking, cybersecurity was really a clear and present danger. Computers networks that run things like subway systems or nuclear power plants, like the one in Iran that's being attacked by that Stuxnet worm, which may very well have been a government-sponsored cyber missile. The problem, according to privacy activists, is that Perfect Citizen might just be used to spy on all computer networks. You think? They're doing it already. Abuses by the National Security Agency, it was revealed by a whistleblower a couple of years ago, and this led to a lawsuit by the Electronic Frontier Foundation, that the NSA actually installed a fiber optic splitter in San Francisco that diverted all email, web traffic, and basically web browsing information from AT&T customers to the National Security Agency. Anyone here have an iPhone? Somebody in Washington knows what you've been doing. One expert said this is so massive and so egregious that it's not just a wiretap, it's a country tap. Now, the NSA is not supposed to spy on American citizens. Its brief does not allow for the surveillance of American citizens. However, they get around this very cleverly by inviting liaisons from our colleagues in the UK to come over and sit in at our listening stations. And when an NSA officer wants to spy or find out something about an American citizen, they hand the intercept information to the Brit, who then calls up all the pertinent information while the NSA officer looks over his shoulder. Thus can claim, we didn't do it. And to return the favor, we do the same thing for the Brits at their listening station at Menwith Hill. So, the argument can be made, and is made by some, that as long as all of this data is for the purpose of preserving national security, it's okay. This is all to protect us, is it not? Let's look at one historical example of where this was abused. In the 1930s, some wealthy Americans found it to their advantage to invest in Germany. American law at the time did not allow for the creation of monopolies, but it was very vague as to what we could do when investing overseas. Now, it wasn't necessarily that Standard Oil really supported the policies of the Nazis, but they were after a profit, and from a business perspective, fascism is a very efficient form of government. These transactions were facilitated by a very well-connected Washington law firm called Sullivan and Cromwell. Among the attorneys there were brothers Alan Dulles and John Foster Dulles. This isn't in the notes, I'm winging it here. After World War II, the connection of some very well-known American families like Rockefeller and Bush would have been highly embarrassing because the opinion of the American public toward Adolf Hitler had changed significantly between 1935 and 1945. Alan Dulles had been posted to Geneva, Switzerland as an officer of the OSS, the precursor to the CIA. He smuggled a lot of German men and money out of the country to places like Australia, Argentina, other points in the West. And then later, using his growing influence within the United States government, he was Eisenhower's CIA director, he created a corporation to help repatriate that money to Germany. So the identities and the fortunes of his clients, Rockefeller, Bush, et al., were protected. Now, the Russians figured out pretty quickly that they could infiltrate Western intelligence by putting out agents who pretended to be Nazis who wanted to escape to the West. This infiltration was so effective that Walter Bedell Smith, who preceded Alan Dulles as the director of Central Intelligence, later told the National War College that during the Cold War, the CIA lost about 97% of the agents that we recruited or posted behind the Iron Curtain. 97% liquidated. Now, how do you think that affected American security during the Cold War? But the Rockefellers got their money back. Flash forward to 2007, intelligence expert R.J. Hillhouse, Dr. Hillhouse, was on a government website and found that found a PowerPoint presentation that detailed military and intelligence appropriations for the coming year. This was not supposed to have been posted to a public website. She recognized this very quickly, so she very quickly downloaded it and saved it. And then reverse engineered the budget numbers and found that 70% of the intelligence appropriations budget of the United States is being paid to private contractors. 70%. Now, do you think that some of those entities whose primary responsibility is to return a profit to its investors might have a motive to maybe not fabricate something, but at least shade the information or the conclusions just a little bit. How do you think that affects American security? And we, you and I, are feeding the information, the grist for this mill. But it's not just the NSA. Of course, the FBI is also busy collecting data to protect us. FBI Director Robert Mueller has been pushing since 2006 to require internet service providers to keep logs of what websites you and I visit for up to 2 years. And in July of this year, the Obama administration is now proposing, or has proposed, to expand the range of data that ISPs must keep on file for requests from the FBI and local law enforcement. In other words, they're essentially telling AT&T, Verizon, Comcast, Earthlink, you need to spy on your customers for us and make that information available to us at any time. Now, the FBI, and by the way, to do this without a court order, the FBI can already obtain this information without a court order or a warrant by using a device called the National Security Letter. The information they need only needs to be relevant to an investigation. It means anyone even remotely connected to a subject of interest can find browser history, location data, and so forth, pulled without a warrant. Not only that, the National Security Letter requires that the ISP or telecommunications company keep the request for information secret. AT&T can turn over your GPS data of where you've been making phone calls for the previous 2 years or what have you, but they can't tell you that they've turned that information over to the government. The FBI has also used something called an exigent letter. This is when they go to, say, AT&T and say, we need everything you've got on Derek Gilbert. We need it now. It's time sensitive. We promise the warrant is on the way. And this can be signed by an officer who's not authorized to sign the National Security Letter. But in 2007, FBI Director Mueller admitted that, well, okay, in about 700 cases, there was no real emergency, and the authorization for the information, the warrant, never appeared. Now, Director Mueller assures us that as of 2007, this is no longer being done. The change, by the way, proposed by the Obama administration, as I said, now requires, or would require, if Congress agrees, to broaden the scope of the information beyond just browser history to email information and so forth. Again, made available to law enforcement without a warrant. In other words, the Fourth Amendment to the Constitution, which requires law enforcement to specify to a judge what they're looking for and why they're looking for it in your stuff, does not apply. But the key point of this discussion, I think, is that most of the information that we are providing to the FBI, the NSA, and other counterterror and intelligence offices is being willingly provided. We are giving this up willingly. In fact, the electronic devices, many of which I see in operation at this very moment, are spying on us at any given, for example, your phone. Our phone plan, yours probably too, has an option that allows you to track at any given moment the location of the other people in your network, which is the father of a 20-year-old daughter, sometimes seems like a pretty good idea, but it also means that the phone company and thus law enforcement has access to that information as well. But I'll tell you what, and I think Dwayne here will verify this, as we've talked about this on the telephone, police officers love the iPhone because the phone not only takes pictures for you, it stores geolocation information with each picture. It records, of course, the location data of all the phone calls that you make. It also takes a little screen capture, little picture, every time you switch from one app to another. So a good forensic technician, what would be the official term, Dwayne?
That would be it.
Forensic tech can go into the iPhone and find out exactly what you've been doing, who you've been talking to, what emails you might have sent, where you sent them from, what pictures you took, and where you were at exactly what time you took those pictures. They could basically take the phone apart, retrace your life for as long as you had the phone. Now, the government has been sued. AT&T particularly has been sued. The government has defended the telecommunications companies over giving up this kind of information. There was a lawsuit I mentioned earlier filed by the Electronic Frontier Foundation called Jewel versus NSA, J-E-W-E-L. President Obama campaigned on a promise to repeal immunity for the telecoms. Okay, under President Bush, the Bush administration said the telecommunications companies should be granted immunity for these lawsuits filed for invasion of privacy because they were doing it in the interest of national security. Now, of course, now that he's president, well, the Obama Justice Department filed a brief asking for the suit to be dismissed on the grounds that the president has the privilege of state secrets, which, by the way, is something else he campaigned to repeal. The state secrets privilege says that the government cannot even disclose anything about this particular program in the interest of national security. And, of course, the suit was duly dismissed in January of this year. The ruling was interesting. U.S. District Court Chief Judge Vaughn Walker ruled that so many people were spied upon. You know, that little NSA splitter for AT&T that took all internet traffic and phone traffic to the NSA? So many people were affected, no one person had standing to bring the lawsuit. In other words, as long as they spy on all of us, it's okay! Unbelievable. He called it a generalized grievance. So, the FBI, by the way, and the reason we said hello to them this morning, they have an app that they can download through the telecommunications company to your cell phone that activates the microphone even when it's powered off. The only way to deactivate that particular app, which works on most smartphones, is to take out the battery on your phone. So even when your phone is off, it's conceivable that they could be listening. But not just your phone is spying on you, your car might be spying on you. How many people drive a GM car with OnStar? Did you know that OnStar can activate the microphone in your car and listen in and record that conversation without your knowledge? Yep. Did you know that they can do that even if you let your OnStar subscription lapse? Did you know that they can tell you how many people are in your car at any given moment? Yep. Yeah, Sharon can attest to that. Had a creepy incident with an OnStar operator when she was driving in her sister's Cadillac once. You see, while private companies like OnStar or Microsoft Sync or LoJack, while they claim to protect your privacy, they do to an extent, what they're really protecting is their customer base from their competitors. If the government comes to them and say, we need to know everything that you know about Sharon Gilbert and her vehicle, they can turn it over because they're acting in good faith to cooperate with an investigation into national security. And thus, according to the president, well, the administrations of the last two presidents, they are immune from your lawsuit for violation of privacy. And Sharon points out this, by the way, on with that little star as a symbolic representation of Osiris. But that's a whole other presentation. Your computer is spying on you. Yes, your hard drive has been ruled in one recent court case to be considered plain sight. You see, when an officer comes to your home with a warrant specifying what they're looking for, if they should happen to see something else illegal or pertinent to perhaps another investigation, if it's out in plain sight, am I correct on this? I'm glad we've got a police officer here who can tell me if I'm getting off target here. They can then broaden the scope of their investigation to include this new information. However, a judge has ruled that the contents of your hard drive might as well be laying out on top of your desk because the contents of your hard drive are, for the purposes of the law, in plain sight. You have no expectation of privacy for what you do on your computer, apparently. especially if you do anything over a peer-to-peer network. File sharing, online storage, it's all there. And according to the law, they have the right to look at it as long as you are a person of interest. Now, what do we do on the internet that might contribute to this total security apparatus, this virtual panopticon? Well, of course, Google. Most all of us more than likely use it to search for information on the internet, and Google has a history of cooperating with the NSA. In 2008, Google sold servers to the NSA to help the NSA search through documents. Earlier this year, the NSA returned the favor by helping to harden Google's servers against cyber attack. You might remember earlier this year some news about a sophisticated hack attack on Google that came from China. Google called in the NSA. What price might the NSA have required in return? Don't know that, but one interesting detail that came out of this incident. The hack revealed that Google has built surveillance capabilities into its network. Everything it does, they have the ability to hook in very quickly and look at who is doing what and what's being shared. Now, why would they do that? Why would they build this automated surveillance apparatus into its network? There was a clue provided earlier this year by the head of legal compliance for Sprint. At a conference, which he didn't know was being recorded, by a gentleman from IU, in Indiana University, Sprint's automated system processed 8 million requests for GPS data in a one-year span. 8 million requests from law enforcement for the location of Sprint's customers. And he added that there was no way that they could have humanly complied with that many requests for information from law enforcement. Sprint is not the largest of the wireless phone networks. If Sprint got 8 million, you can bet that Verizon and AT&T received even more requests. And so it is in their best interest to automate the process in order to cut expenses and continue to turn a profit. Google has also invested in certain technologies with the Central Intelligence Agency. Now, this is not the official logo of the CIA, but a artist representation of, well, perhaps just a political comment on Google's cooperation with the CIA. They invested, you may not know this, but the CIA has its own venture capital firm. Yeah, we'll talk about that in just a minute. It's called InQtel. They invested in a company called Recorded Future. The CIA and Google invested about $10 million each last year. Recorded Future trawls the internet and predicts future events, much like the Tom Cruise character from the Department of Pre-Crime in the movie Minority Report. It collects data from the internet and predicts future events. The data that we provide through our web browsing, emails, and telephone calls. They also mutually invested in a company called Keyhole, which is now the backbone of Google Earth. Google essentially has its fingers in just about every online pie you can imagine. Its best known function, of course, is online searching. But it doesn't just search for you. Google places a cookie. Are you familiar with the term cookie? It's a little file that is stored on your computer to identify you when you return, so you can save preferences. Like when I go to ESPN.com, they know that I want to find out what happened to the Bears and how badly they beat the Packers last weekend, Russ. So it stores those kind of preferences. But what Google was doing was it put a unique identifier on your computer, and then the cookie didn't expire until the year 2038. 2038. Now, how many of you expect to be using the same PC in 2038? I mean, the point is, it would follow your computer until that computer bit the dust. Now, privacy advocates complained about this, and so Google said, okay, all right, we get it. And now it's only a two-year expiration date on the cookie with the unique tracking identifier, but the date refreshes every time you go back to Google. So, again, for the life of your car, your mileage may vary. And they're not alone. Other search engines do the same thing. Bing, Yahoo, they do distant expiration dates as well to track your computer and what you're doing through their services. Now, how does Google respond to complaints that this is a violation of privacy? Well, Google CEO Eric Schmidt, seen there with another famous guy, said, if you have something you don't want anyone to know, maybe you shouldn't be doing it in the first place. If you really need that kind of privacy, the reality is that search engines, including Google, do retain this information for some time. And it's important, for example, that we are all subject in the United States to the Patriot Act, and that it is possible that all that information could be made available to the authorities. Other aspects of Google's reach across the internet, of course, Google Chrome, the new web browser, which is faster than the others, so we use it. Gmail, how many people have Gmail accounts? Okay, well, all your contacts are belong to them. Google Maps and Street View, there have been some privacy complaints of cameras getting too close to houses, like, well, well, look there, there's the bunker. And you know, you can almost read the license plate number on Brian and Lori's van next door. Google Earth, we mentioned that. You also get a nice overhead shot of just about any place on planet Earth, like, oh, well, there's the bunker again, a top view. Google, by the way, markets a higher resolution version of this to intelligence agencies around the world. Other things that Google does online, shopping, Google Checkout, that's an alternative to PayPal, social networking like Google Buzz and Google Wave, Google Groups, all of your interests are known to them and the people with whom you associate. Google Calendar, who uses that to coordinate between various machines? Yeah, I use it, phone, iPod, laptop, desktop, all that stuff stored on Google servers and might be made available to the authorities. Videos, Google, by the way, owns YouTube. Google Desktop, you can install an app onto your laptop and let Google search your hard drive for you. Google Health, store all your medical records online on Google servers, now protected by the NSA. Google Documents, of course, you can store all your letters and spreadsheets and presentations online. Picasa for online photo storage. Blogger, anyone have a blogspot.com account? You ever read a blog and somebody's at blogspot.com? That's hosted on Google servers, they own it. And Google is now marketing a new operating system called Chrome, Chrome OS, which is based on the concept of cloud computing, and we'll talk about that in just a second. Google is, in effect, has become a reality interface. When you do a Google search, say for a fast food restaurant or an Italian place or a tire distributor, what do you think of the people, the companies that are like on the 10th or 12th page of the search results? Frankly, for most of us, they might as well not exist. Or we think they're probably not worth anything because they weren't among the top 10 hits. Google shapes our perception of reality by the searches that they return to us. Perception is reality. Search for a company, if they're not among the top hits, they might as well not exist. Google, incidentally, is also, and remember this point, a corporate founder of Singularity University. We'll talk about that in just a couple of minutes. Cloud computing, what is it? It is essentially where the apps and the data are all stored on their servers or someone's servers on the internet. Your computer or your processing device only becomes an interface with the cloud. In fact, most of us probably do some form of cloud computing. Gmail, Hotmail, Yahoo Mail, all stored on their servers, cloud computing. Photo services, Flickr, Picasa, cloud computing. Oh yeah, Facebook. All your friends are belong to us. Facebook, over 500 million users as of July of this year. That's equivalent to the populations, combined populations of the United States, France, and Germany. One of its principal investors early on is this fellow, Peter Thiel. He's a billionaire, the co-founder, former CEO of PayPal, considered one of the brightest minds in the investment world, invests heavily in new technologies, especially those that involve bringing people together via the internet. He's a member of the Singularity Institute for Artificial Intelligence. There's that word again, singularity. Remember that we'll talk about the Singularity Institute in just a bit. He invested back in 2004 about $500,000 and got himself a 10% share of Facebook, which means that on top of the, well, like I said, he's a billionaire, so he's doing fine. He's also invested in web startups and websites like LinkedIn, which is a business site that brings people together to share curriculum vitae and resumes and so forth. Friendster, Yelp, Yammer, which is like Twitter, but more secure for corporate communications internally. Genie.com for genealogy buffs like me. All get together through social networks in which Peter Thiel has invested. And we will come back to this gentleman in just a bit. Another investor in Facebook, surprise, surprise, InQtel, the venture capital firm of the Central Intelligence Agency. Now, what potential benefit would you see for the CIA in investing in a firm that brings together networks of people who share common interests? InQtel, CIA funds it with about $37 million a year. And as of, 2006, this is old data, they put about $150 million into over 5,800 business plans. You see, they determined as far back as 2004 that they weren't keeping up with the pace of development in Silicon Valley. So rather than trying to hire the geeks into the CIA, they just decided to give the geeks money to do what they wanted to do anyway, and then benefit from the technology that came to market. One of their other investments, which is kind of interesting, is a company called Visible Technologies, which is a company that monitors social networks like Facebook, Twitter, and then develops intelligence analyses for corporate clients based on that. Again, just another means of mining the data that we provide through our tweets and our posts and our likes and coming to conclusions about us, basically profiling us through the information that we willingly provide. This is a subject that has puzzled me for quite some time. In fact, there was an article that was just posted to a tech website the other day as to why is Farmville so popular when it isn't really any fun? Now, I know there are some who disagree. I mean, Sharon loves to play Farmville. It's a way for, you know, she and her sisters get together through Farmville and trade stuff back and forth all the time. But it's a game that never ends. You can't ever win in Farmville. And yet, Farmville, Frontierville, Zynga Poker, all those little games that you get to through Facebook have over 226 million users a month. People who go online and play these flash games and develop networks of friends through these games. Google just bought, or rather invested $100 million in the company that developed Farmville and Frontierville and Petville and Cafe World and Zynga Poker. What benefit to Google from people who play these games and build networks of friends to these games? They're looking for that same sort of Facebook social network data. In fact, there are rumors that this is the first step toward Google building a Facebook competitor. What happens to all of that data? Those networks of friends that we have built for them? Not sure. But it may be provided to law enforcement authorities to comply with the Patriot Act. Twitter, another popular social networking tool, over 100 million users, I should say. This was really in the news during the Iranian presidential campaign and the uprisings that they had on the streets of Tehran. It was disclosed about halfway through that whole episode that intelligence services on both sides of the ocean were using Twitter to try to get their particular version of the truth to the masses. In fact, the United States government asked Twitter to delay a scheduled maintenance shutdown the weekend of the presidential election in Iran. This request came from the U.S. Department of State. Interesting. Your private tweets, by the way, not exactly private. We've not yet succeeded in transmitting that message to our daughter. But just as with anything else you do on the internet, you might as well assume that whatever you tweet, post, like, dislike, you might as well post it to your next resume. Another interesting technology, and I think one that may have even more potential to provide grist for the national security state mill, is this company, Second Life. Are you familiar with this? You can't even call it a game. It's not really a game. Second Life is, with 18 million registered users, is kind of small potatoes compared to what Facebook has put together. But it's really interesting in that Second Life is essentially a user-created 3D virtual world. This slide depicts a kind of a virtual meeting that's taking place where the users create their own avatars and can interact in real time with one another. It kind of must have been an interesting business meeting, because you see this fellow here chose to represent himself as the Kool-Aid man. But again, with Second Life, there is no goal. You get into this world, you create an avatar the way you want to represent yourself to the rest of the users in that world. You build, buy real estate, build structures, and there are large corporations that are now constructing virtual offices inside.
Welcome to Seltra, your fully equipped secure center for virtual corporate meetings and events. At Seltra, we use Second Life technology to provide a serious alternative to the traditional face-to-face and video conferencing events. An alternative that is environmentally friendly, an alternative that is available to use at any time in your own premises with no extra equipment or setup costs, and an alternative that will allow you to make significant savings for each and every event you hold. Getting started is really easy. Our comprehensive service supports you from your very first steps, and we guarantee to have you up and running in just 10 minutes. And our support is there for you to even the most advanced level. Participants put their own personal identity together from a simple, easy-to-use menu. Then, using interactive demonstrations and trials, they will quickly and easily develop the necessary skills for navigation, presentations, meetings, and communications. Planning on hosting a meeting or event? Before you finalise those plans, why not consider the benefits of letting Seltra host it for you? There really are no limits to what you can do. With Seltra staff on hand at all times, cutting-edge technology gives you the power to share ideas, stream live internet medias, keep notes, use interactive content, deliver presentations, and break out into private areas for roleplay and discussion. Consider the possibility of abandoning those travel plans, cancelling that expensive venue, scrapping those hotel costs, taking back those days spent away from the office, and being environmentally responsible without the high costs of video conferencing. Think about the tangible savings: time, money, and carbon. Then imagine how impressed your clients and colleagues will be with your innovative use of technology. All of this really is possible using our service. If you would like to find out more about our service and how Seltra can help your business to save money and carbon while increasing productivity, please contact us at sales@seltra.org.
I had to laugh, though, when they talked about breaking out into private sessions for role play, as if this whole thing isn't role play.
Yeah.
Kool-Aid man. But this is the direction the technology is going. And especially if they can sell it to the environmentally concerned that this saves carbon. We can all put ourselves into the matrix and just interact virtually this way. So watch for this to become a bigger player in the corporate world, not just for people who want to interact with one another in a virtual reality. And you can really lose yourself in this game, by the way, because it is, when I say happening in real time, unlike Farmville, where you plant a crop and you get a whole field full of pumpkins in a couple of hours, this is real time. You know, so to get anything productive done, there is a one-to-one correlation in terms of the amount of time you put in. You can spend days inside there. And it frankly kind of creeps me out. And again, it's all happening through the internet with companies that may provide the data to that to the authorities. Other social networks out there that trade information back and forth, there's a company called Foursquare that is essentially like a, it's like a Zynga role-playing game. You actually go out and travel about, and as you go to various locations, you check in and you get points and rewards for checking in and telling people where you are at any given moment. Yeah, so of course your movements are being recorded and tracked, but you get points. You get points. Yelp, which is like Facebook meets GPS, meets Consumer Reports. You go around and tell people what you think of the newest restaurant you just tried. And again, it's sending not just your location data, but networks of your friends and associates to somebody up there in the cloud who then, again, may be required at some point to provide that information to the authorities. RFID, technology we probably have heard an awful lot about, radio frequency identification. We got tags that are being used for all kinds of things now. Shipping containers, identifying material in boxes very quickly as they move from place to place. We've talked, and you probably have read about implantable RFID chips, Digital Angel, Verichip. Sam is chipped, isn't he? Sam Dachshund?
Yeah.
Our Dachshund has a chip. But hey, if you really want your child to be safe, why not have your child chipped? Why don't you, if you've got medical, special medical requirements or things that emergency responders might need to know, why don't you take a chip as well? And of course, that information, digitized, recorded someplace. And it's not stopping there. Just read a press release a couple of weeks ago about a company called Proteus, which is proposing ingestible chips. Yes, ingestible chips. You take a certain medication that you are required to take for maintaining your mood or your cholesterol level or what have you. The chip, activated by your stomach juices, sends a little signal to a wearable receiver. And if the medicine level goes below a certain point, it can automatically notify your doctor or the hospital or the authorities, perhaps. Now again, it's sort of a really high-tech version of that, what is the I've fallen and I can't get up thing. So, because it's automatic, which makes it better. Other means of being tracked via your movements, of course, again, as I said, we sort of take for granted anymore thanks to CSI, Law and Order. You know, we've sort of become accustomed to police procedure, at least the basics of it. You use a credit card anywhere, the authorities can find you pretty quickly. And like I said, it has been so ingrained in us anymore that we sort of take it as suspicious if somebody wants to go in and pay cash for an item that costs more than a couple of bucks. And of course, those purchases that you've made can be tracked and used for profiling. He's buying an awful lot of prophecy books. He must be one of them. So why do we submit to all of this? Why are we feeding all of this information into this national security state? Well, convenience. What's in your wallet? Nobody wants to be the person holding up the line at the checkout counter searching for exact change. And of course, you can get through the toll road, the toll booth on the toll road a lot faster if you've got a speed pass or an RFID tag on your license plate. It's convenient. Internet commerce, like buying tickets to this particular conference, is facilitated by using that little piece of plastic, is it not? Security. We want to be safe. And if the government is watching what everybody's doing, we can keep guys like this from showing up here in Canton, Ohio. Now, prior to 9/11, what could the American government have possibly said to you to get you to agree to full body x-ray scans at the airport, to invading Afghanistan and Iraq, to monitoring all of your phone calls and emails, to being under near constant surveillance on closed circuit TV, not to mention the President of the United States claiming the authority to imprison or assassinate American citizens without warrant or judicial oversight or congressional oversight of any kind. Because that, ladies and gentlemen, is the world in which we live right now. The Obama administration claims the right to assassinate American citizens without warrant or due process of any kind. The father of that Yemeni sheikh, who is reportedly responsible for the Fort Hood massacre, has filed a lawsuit against the government, trying to file an injunction against the government to get him off of the assassination list. And the Obama administration once again has invoked the state secrets privilege. It's so secret he can't even talk about it. And so the suit was dismissed. We want to be secure at home. We also want our children to be secure. Do you know where your child is? Well, if your child was chipped, you might. Or, of course, if they had one of those phones with the family plan where you could see where that phone is at any given moment. And, of course, in case of a severe accident, we want to know that help is forthcoming quickly. Not all of these are bad things, but these are the motives for us to comply and to willingly give up this information to the total security state. Entertainment, another motive. In our house, we use the internet for research. We also use it to stream movies via Netflix on our Roku boxes. There are other devices, other entertainment services out there like Boxy and Hulu and Fancast and Juiced. All kinds of ways that these can be streamed to you, but of course, though, that browsing history is being recorded. What kind of videos are you watching? Oh, watch some videos from YouTube from that conference in Nashville. Web content that we find entertaining, forums, or is it fora? Fora, yeah. News information, and of course games like Farmville. All that browsing history, going someplace, and again, if the government has its way, recorded and saved by all ISPs for up to 2 years. Sadly, another motive, and one that we have to be on guard about, is that the use of these electronic devices can be a substitute for community. I think the fact that we're here today indicates that we've got a desire for community, to get together with others and fellowship, but it can serve as a substitute. Now, there is an impact on family and community. How many of us with teens have not seen a picture like this? I'd bet dollars to donuts, and by the way, that's Miley Cyrus on the right there, but I'd bet dollars to donuts she's texting her friend and vice versa. University up in Canada did a study on Facebook and how it can affect relationships and found that it causes increased jealousy. It actually harmed relationships. Now, the survey sample was college students, maybe a little younger and less secure, but you can see the point. You get one partner in a relationship spending all time online, especially chatting with people unknown, perhaps people of a different sex. That can drive a real wedge between a couple. Noel Shepard, who's an associate editor of a website called newsbusters.org, wrote a column in which he related an incident where he and his wife hosted a party for his daughter's soccer team, and the parents were all gathered out in the kitchen and just laughing and joking and telling stories and whatnot, and they looked in on the girls to see how they were doing, a bunch of 13-year-old girls. They were all slumped on couches and on the floor of the family room with their phones out, texting each other. They weren't talking, they were texting from the other side of the living room. Yes, it is stupid, but it is real. And this is how technology is affecting us and breaking up our families. Why might this be significant? I heard a wise man once say that the family unit is the smallest battle formation in the spiritual war. And that's why the enemy spends so much effort trying to break it up. This is just one more way. And another way, by the way, is that the internet, as I'm sure you know, while it's a wonderful tool for research, for study, for connecting the way we have today, also pipes the very worst of humanity into our homes, unfiltered. Raw sewage, pornography, child molesters. It's not really a surprise that nearly every major advance in streaming video technology on the internet came about to facilitate delivering pornography faster and with less bandwidth. So what are the possible motives of those who gain from global control, exercising global control through all of this information that we provide to them? Well, history has shown us nothing else. It has certainly shown us that those in power tend to consolidate power. They want more of it. Our interconnected world is still, at least at some level, governed locally. Yes, the government can look in on just about everything we do, but the school lunch schedule is still determined by your local school board, trash schedule by the city council. So we still have some local control over what happens here to us. But again, just looking at history, I don't think it's a stretch to say that they would like to encourage, like to gain control even over those aspects of our lives. From a business standpoint, global markets means larger profits. National boundaries and nationalism pose obstacles to profit. In fact, the Security and Prosperity Partnership, we talked about quite a lot on PID Radio, the North American Union, one of the goals, one of the reasons that this was proposed was to facilitate more efficient movement of labor resources across the southern border. But of course, national boundaries pose an obstacle. There's also a trend that's worth watching over the next few years. This has begun just within the last couple of years as investors, wealthy Westerners, have recognized the truth in the old Mark Twain maxim, buy land, they're not making it anymore. There is a land rush taking place in the third world. Farmland. Western investors with lots of money figuring out that the next great war might be over food, not oil, water and food. And so they're buying up land in countries that don't have strong laws against foreign ownership. Now, there are still some countries that do have strong laws against foreign ownership, and we'll just have to do something about those uppity natives, won't we? There is a powerful incentive to break down those national barriers for that purpose. In fact, would it surprise you to know that the Bush family owns, what is it, about 90,000 acres? About 90,000 acres down in South America on the Guarani Aquifer, which is the largest underground freshwater aquifer on planet Earth. One of their neighbors, by the way, is Sun Myung Moon down there. What benefit to the Bush family or to the Unification Church to own land on top of a huge freshwater aquifer? Currencies, local and regional currencies, can also be an obstacle to trade. Break down the barriers, you eliminate the fluctuations in value between one currency and another. In fact, a recent news item you might have heard, U.S. Congress is threatening sanctions on China because China has pegged its yuan to the dollar, making their exports to the United States unnaturally cheap. You eliminate all that, you eliminate those fluctuations, you eliminate the problems, at least from the perspective of being a guy who wants to rule the world. There is also a very strong religious component to all of this. The New Age, Gnostics or Neo-Gnostics. The more I began to research this topic, the more I began to finally grasp what Tom Horn, Russ Dizdar have been talking about for the last several years. Because a lot of these technical advances that are being pushed, and with some pretty heavy investors behind it, aren't just to facilitate faster communications and global commerce. There is a theological, a spiritual component to this. The goal is, in fact, apotheosis. The old lie. In fact, the oldest lie. Ye shall be as gods. The role of science and technology in all of this? Well, the belief that science will somehow overcome all of our problems, will cure aging so that we can live forever, is at its root Luciferian. It is based on what our friends Paul and Philip Collins would say, call an anthropocentric soteriology, meaning salvation through our own works. We become the instruments of our salvation. It is based on the neo-Gnostic myth of Darwinism, that matter somehow willed itself into existence. And since that point, every day, in every way, we're getting better and better. Until we suddenly reach that point, the singularity, in which we become as gods. Technology may facilitate this apotheosis by transcending the limits of human biology. And Tom Horn will talk about this a little more later today. For techno-gnostics, the singularity, which is essentially the point at which we achieve the means to amplify human intelligence or create artificial intelligence. This research is ongoing and well-funded. Even though its proponents admit it's not really clear whether this is a good thing. You see, in practical terms, if you believe in a Star Trek future, having a Lieutenant Commander Data on your team could really be a handy thing. That's a good return on investment. He's really, really smart, smarter than a human, and can come up with the answers you need pretty quickly. However, Star Trek also suggested a potential downside to creating a transhuman life form that's a lot smarter than us.
I am Locutus of Borg. Resistance is futile. Your life as it has been is over. From this time forward, you will service us.
That scene still creeps me out 20 years later. Now, back to Peter Thiel, real world. Peter Thiel, billionaire, co-founder of PayPal, early investor in Facebook, co-founder of the Singularity Summit. His Thiel Foundation defends and promotes freedom in all its dimensions, political, personal, and economic. He's also supporting research to cure aging, as though getting older is a disease that needs a cure. The other co-founder of this Singularity Summit is Dr. Raymond Kurzweil. He's the author of a book called The Singularity Is Near: When Humans Transcend Biology. From the website for the book, the singularity is an era in which our intelligence will become increasingly non-biological. Our intelligence will become increasingly non-biological and trillions of times more powerful than it is today. The dawning of a new civilization that will enable us to transcend our biological limitations and amplify our creativity. Now, Kurzweil is also the founder of the Singularity University. This is a forum for entrepreneurs to meet with some of the leading lights in promising technologies, including genetics, robotics, artificial intelligence, and nanotechnology, or the so-called GRIN technology that Tom Horn will be talking about later today. This is a well-funded institution. The whole idea that it's going to create artificial intelligence safely. I just bring back that image just to creep you out a little more. This is well-funded. The corporate founders of Singularity University include, surprise, Google and Autodesk. Any engineers here that use CAD software, AutoCAD, Autodesk? They're behind Singularity University as well. According to Kurzweil, the six epochs of evolution began with physics and chemistry, information held in subatomic particles and atoms. As evolution progressed, we moved to the second epoch, biology and DNA, information stored in DNA. Then we moved to brains, information stored in our neural patterns and transmitted verbally. The fourth epoch, the technology epoch, information stored in hardware and software, which is where we are today. The fifth epoch, the singularity, the merger of technology with human intelligence. I am Locutus of Borg. And here is the key to where this is headed. Epoch 6. The universe wakes up. This is what they're pushing toward. The cosmos becomes saturated, and all inanimate matter becomes substrates for computation. The universe becomes a sentient superintelligence of which we are all a part. Does this sound like Eastern mysticism to you? Cosmos is intelligent. God is all, and all are God. ye shall be as gods. And we get there by technology. So, where does this lead? Well, first and foremost, to get there, I think this leads to alternate horn, the other horn of this dialectic bull, which is a move toward the same goal, essentially, by those who profess to be Christians. We would call dominionists, or kingdom now theology. Christian reconstructionists, perhaps, another term. The goal is the same, using the state as a means, as a tool to salvation. The goal, very much like the New Age movement, is to create heaven on earth. Literally, create heaven on earth. And by the way, when you discuss the New Age movement and these guys like Kurzweil or the Dominion movement, you find yourself using the word literally a lot. As in, you know, no, they literally believe this. Literally, they believe that we need to reclaim the seven mountains of culture, because until we retake dominion over planet Earth, Jesus will not return. In other words, we become the means of salvation because he's waiting for us to wield the sword for him. Until we reclaim the worlds of business, government, family, religion, media, education, and entertainment, those seven mountains, Jesus will not return. And interestingly, there's a new book just been published by leading ufologist Nick Redfern called Final Events. And I'm going to interview him in a couple of weeks. In this book, he discloses or reveals a think tank, rather secretive think tank, inside the intelligence community, those guys who are gathering up all this data and analyzing it. They believe, this group, which calls itself the Collins Elite, that UFOs are demonic, manifestation of fallen angels. That's okay as far as it goes, but they believe the solution is to implement a Christian reconstructionist government on the United States. In other words, we all must live according to the Old Testament laws to save our souls from Lucifer. Yeah, as if becoming Pharisees will save us from the enemy. But either way, technology, it's again not a stretch, it's speculation, but not too much to imagine how this sort of technology, this surveillance under which we find ourselves, might be used. Leading new apostle, one of the leading names among this movement, Rick Joyner, admitted as much. He posted to the Elijah List back in 2007 that this kingdom of God that these men are pushing, men and women are pushing toward, may at first seem like totalitarianism, as the Lord will destroy the Antichrist spirit now dominating the world. Instead of taking away liberties and becoming more domineering, the kingdom of God will move from a point of necessary control while people are learning truth, integrity, honor, and how to make decisions. In other words, we make them slaves until they learn how to live right. Does that sound like the liberty promised by Jesus Christ? Free will? But there is a significant and growing movement inside the hyper-charismatic wing of Christianity that believes this. And where does this lead? Oh, incidentally, I should point out that Joyner has formed his own political action committee called the Oak Initiative. They held their first conference 2 weekends ago. And according to their website and the agenda, their first order of business was to set up a Christian intelligence service, because they need watchmen that they can trust. So where does this lead? The global panopticon. The panopticon was developed by an 18th century philosopher and architect named Jeremy Bentham. In his words, the panopticon was a building circular, the prisoners in their cells occupying the circumference, the officers in the center. By blinds and other contrivances, the inspectors concealed from the observation of the prisoners. Hence the sentiment of a sort of omnipresence, the whole circuit reviewable with little or without any change of place, one station in the inspection part affording the most perfect view of every cell. An example of the panopticon is a prison in Cuba called the Presidio Modelo, or the Model Prison. You can see the cells all around the exterior of the circumference. the observation point in the center. The prisoners, never knowing when they're being watched. Never knowing when they're being watched. Other examples of a panopticon include the Stateville Correctional Center in Chicago, in downstate Illinois. So I'm from Chicago. Everywhere outside Chicago is downstate. In Los Angeles, the Twin Towers Correctional Facility, built in 2007, the world's largest jail, a panopticon, in which the prisoners can be watched from a central location by a minimum of staff. Now, how is that any different from this? National Security Agency headquarters. The influence of the panopticon, it's ingenious, which is why Bentham's influence is still being felt 200 years later. It's more than a physical restraint. It's a psychological restraint. The threat of constant surveillance, knowing that we're being watched at all times, modifies our behavior, does it not? Never knowing when you might receive a visit from a man in black because of something you said or done or emailed or posted to your blog or exchanged in confidence inside your OnStar-equipped vehicle. The prisoners become the objects of their own imprisonment. The prisoners become the instruments, that's the word I was looking for, become the instruments of their own imprisonment. And again, I encourage you to go back and watch the 1960s television series, The Prisoner, which illustrates this concept beautifully. Bentham had hoped that his design would become the model jail used by the French Revolution. It didn't, and nor did it influence the design, but it certainly was a precursor of the Soviet Gulag or the Nazi concentration camp of the World War, of Second World War. See, above the door of Bentham's panopticon was to be a sign with these words: had they been industrious when free, they need not have drudged here like slaves. Does that phrase remind you of anything? Sound familiar at all? How about this sign from about 70 years ago? Work will make you free. The sign above the front gate at Auschwitz. What Bentham was actually proposing was a slave labor camp in which the criminals, the indigent, the mentally defective, and their children would be put to work in cells with primitive machinery, powered by a central power source, which was charged by the swings, merry-go-rounds, and seesaws in the children's cell block. Wow. That was Bentham's panopticon. We have a slightly different panopticon today, but not all that different. The implications of the panopticon, of course, physical control. Security forces have an all-seeing eye with which to keep tabs on what we're doing. Resistance to government policies, of course, become more difficult because resistance is easier to crush. Psychological control. If you know you're being watched, you don't put your hand in the cookie jar. And a docile, pliable population, of course, is thus more easily led. And, of course, spiritual control. We live under what, our friends, the Collins brothers, would call a scientific dictatorship. What we know and how we know it is controlled and has been guided since the 19th century by a group that has essentially established the criteria by which our colleges and universities, secondary schools, are accredited. Your degree only counts for something if it comes from an accredited institution. The institution is only accredited if it teaches science and a worldview that is based on the neo-Gnostic myth of Darwinism. Matter willed itself to life and is gradually moving toward that point of apotheosis. It's a consensus worldview, and many of our Christian institutions, churches, have bought into it, or at least part of it, because it's so scientific. So what do we do about all of this? That's the big question. What do we as Christians, Bible-believing Christians, who see that this is happening, what do we do? In the words of Douglas Adams, don't panic. Now, Mr. Adams, sadly, as far as we know, was an atheist up to the point that he drew his last breath, which is truly a shame because he was a brilliant man and a brilliant writer. However it comes about, however science and technology play a role in moving toward this one-world government, this one-world theocracy, it was prophesied a couple millennia ago. We have been warned. We know this is coming. We know we're in for a rough ride. And as sober and vigilant watchmen, per Scripture, we are not to be ignorant of the enemy's designs. What do we do? Suggestions? Pray. Hard. Fast. And dare I suggest even a fast from these technological wonders that have made the world so much more convenient and entertaining and secure. And when things get really bad, reread the end of the book. Spoiler, the good guys win. Final observation. The technology, and I think this is really the amazing thing that really is cool. This technology that we take for granted, that we depend on, that brought us together today, is actually fulfilling prophecy. Oh, and it's not going to display, is it? Well, we could, but I could describe it. Essentially, this is a scene from Doctor Who. This worked in the hotel last night. That's all right. Let's go ahead and skip to the next one. Yeah. There was a scene from an episode of Doctor Who earlier this year, and I know I'm running a little over time, and I apologize for that, but in which the Doctor's companion, and everything we've learned from Star Trek and Doctor Who, by the way. Doctor Who is, and the prisoner. A doctor's companion looks up and sees the sun beginning to flare and shine more brightly in a very ominous and threatening fashion, and she asks, "What's it? What is this? What's happening?" And the doctor says, "Oh, don't worry. They've just sealed off the upper atmosphere and they're getting ready to boil the planet." And she stares at him in disbelief. And then the doctor looks and sees a group of people gathered together in the commons area of this small, idyllic northern England town, looking up at the sun as it flares and shines, holding their phones like this. And the doctor says, "Oh, there they are, the human race. Look at them. The end of the world coming, as it always would, down a video phone." Now think about this. "Then will appear in heaven the sign of the Son of Man, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory." For the first time in recorded history, I mean, this was always spiritually possible, but for the first time in recorded history, it is now technologically possible for us to watch a single event occurring in a single place on planet Earth, everywhere at once in real time. Thanks to the internet, 24-hour cable news networks, and yes, your video phone, we can now see all of this happening in real time, just as it was prophesied millennia ago. And I say, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Amen. A quick thank you to Paul and Philip Collins, authors of the excellent book, The Ascendancy of the Scientific Dictatorship, who helped me to focus my thoughts in this presentation. They don't necessarily agree with my conclusions. That's okay. This book is an essential addition to your research library. I highly recommend it. Look it up on the internet. Get a copy and look at, and you'll see the connections between what we, our children, have been taught and where we are headed toward this global panopticon through the use of the technology that we take for granted. I thank you for your attention today, and look forward to meeting each of you throughout the course of the weekend. And praise God, hallelujah. He's in control.